All right, so the talk's about called Big Spikes and Blocks, and has to do with binary programming in JavaScript. And my intention behind the talk is essentially to promote this idea that, you know, we don't deal with binary. So, you know, pretty much all of computer science is essentially abstraction, right? We look at a ball and we say, you know what, it isn't really a ball, it's a wheel. And we just start calling it wheel for the entire step, right? So everybody else on top thinks it's a wheel, but really it's a ball, right? So this is kind of fundamental behind, software in general, and a lot of technology. It is the same fundamental about behind binary. We call one signal one, and we call the other signal zero. And then after that, we call this abstraction. We stick with this abstraction, and all the software layers on top just think that they're getting a one and a zero, right? I recently saw an example of a TED talk where somebody was transferring data, right? And it's kind of the same principle that you have, you know, the light spectrum and you have two frequencies of light. You send one frequency and the other guy thinks this is zero. You send another frequency and the other guy thinks it's one, right? So that's kind of the fundamental. But once we have this abstraction layer in place, what we do is we build other abstraction layers on top. So the moment we have one and zero in place, we build these so-called things called data types. And in all our programming languages, we just deal with data types. But what if for a minute in JavaScript, we move below our data types and we start looking at data back in the ones and zeros forms? Can we get some advantages from it? So, you know, why think in binary, right? We have a perfectly good abstraction of data types, right? We can think in integers, we can think in strings, we can think in arrays. But why think in binary? Thinking in binary helps because whoever designed the language didn't know your use case, right? So when you have certain specific cases, it can help thinking in binary. You could get, you know, better data transfer, like you could send less data over the network. You could get faster processing of the data. You could do things quickly just because you know what the binary information looks like. And if you didn't, you would spend more time doing it, right? So that's kind of the basic of why you want to do it. You also might want to do it, you know, to comply with existing standards. You want to implement a client to an existing protocol that is binary, you right? And you need to deal with that information. So these kind of things take you to this level of thinking in binary. And I personally think that we don't do this enough, especially in the web application world. We're stuck with our data types, and even if we're thinking in a different data type, we think in text-based data types, which are way too bulky, and we could think of them differently, and we'll get into that in a little bit. So this is basic math, okay, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the basics because I know that at least I didn't remember my college binary mathematics class. So I'm going to revise it as quickly as possible in the room so that everybody has those basics afresh so that we can discuss the other stuff, right? But to really understand binary numbers, you need to understand decimal numbers. And we all know decimal numbers really well, right? We've dealt with decimal numbers since forever, since we started learning mathematics. So they're basically, decimal numbers have 10 digits, right? And because they have 10 digits, they're called base 10 numbers. So let's take this number, for example, you know, which is kind of assumed to be the answer to everything. So we have 42 in decimal, right? We could write 42 in decimal as 2 into 10 to the power 0, right? Which is 1, 2. 4 into 10 to the power 1, which is 40, right? So this is how we get 40 plus 2, and we get 42. And this is a very generic formula. It works for every decimal number, which is essentially that, you know, you take the digit. So whatever 0 to 9 digit that you have, you take the digit, you multiply it by the number of digits, which is the base. In decimal, we have 10 digits, so 10. And the position. So you start measuring the position from here. This is 0th position, this is first position, second position, third position, so forth. You can have an infinitely long number like that. So if you start thinking about this formula, right, you could, you know, extend it and you could say, okay, this is the 0th position, first position, second position. At the second position, this becomes, you know, 8 into 10 to the power 10 to the power 2, which gives me 800. So I can get 842, which is the number, by looking at the data like this. And what is the advantage of looking at the data like this is because, you know, this will help us thinking of other number systems. So that's why we kind of got the basic. But this is the important formula. The digit, the number of digits, so a particular digit at that position, the number of digits and the position. So you raise to that power and you get, you know, you can calculate whatever number value. So binary numbers are kind of similar. They have, instead of 10 digits, they have 2 digits, right? So because they have 2 digits, they're called base 2 numbers, right? And a binary digit has either 0 or 1 and it's called a bit. So it's kind of the same thing. So now let's say I have this binary number, right? I have 1 and a 0 in binary. So how will I understand this number? You know, I'll go back to my same formula, which is, okay, so what is the digit at this location? 0. What is the base? 2, right? And what is the position? 0 in this case, right? So if I expand this, it will look something like this, that, you know, 0 the digit, 2 the base, and 0 the position, then 2 the base, 1 the position, and 1 the digit, right? So I could then calculate that, okay, this is 2 plus 0, which is essentially 2. I could extend this with any number of digits, right? And it doesn't have to, you know, important thing to remember when you start dealing with binary data, this isn't limited by bytes. It can go on till whatever number of binary numbers, right? The formula still will continue applying. You don't have to think in bytes, you can think in bigger numbers. And that's important to remember. So we have a binary digit, but we have slightly better ways of thinking of it, you know, slightly higher level abstractions, if you will. So we had binary digits, which were called bits. We club 4 of them together and we start thinking of them as nibbles. Generally, we don't use these nibbles a lot, but they're important in one place, and I will get to that in a little bit. But basically, what's important to note is we can store 0 to 15 in a nibble, right? And if you know hexadecimal numbers, 0 to 15 should mean something to you. So, a byte is 2 nibbles, but 8 bits, and it can store 0 to 255 values. The same formulas apply, you know, we can, if we have bit values filled in, we can apply the same formula to calculate the value. So similarly, you know, just like we had base 10 numbers, we had base 2 numbers, similarly have base 16 numbers. And base 16 numbers have 16 digits, 0 through F, and that's why they're called base 16. But what's really interesting about hexadecimal numbers is that hex digits fit exactly into a binary nibble. And this is important, right? So 4 bits can be represented by a hex digit. This is important because when you start writing ones and zeros, right, lots of them, it just becomes hard to read. So we want a way to compress and read efficiently. And hex is a nice way to read this stuff. So because I can take, so let me explain that. Right, so let's say I add this one nibble, 11111, right? The value of this is 15. 15 in hex is A. So I could write this nibble as A, right? And that's kind of key, because now I can write AA, and that will tell me that it is 15 followed by, you know, 111 followed by 111. And that makes binary information readable the moment you start writing in hex. It is so useful that we have a hexadecimal notation in JavaScript, right? A way to write hex numbers in hex. That's because we don't have a binary notation, sadly. There should be, some languages do. But we have a hexadecimal notation, right? And it makes things easy. Sorry? What did I do? Oh, sorry. My mistake. F and F. So byte order. People are listening, that's good. Another important concept to understand is byte order, right? So what we've done so far is we created the first level of abstraction. We extracted a signal out to 1 and 0, right? 2 different signals into 1 and 0. The next level of abstraction we created was, you know what, let's take a bunch of these signals together and call them a nibble first, then take 8 of them together and call them a byte, right? But once you have bytes, an issue arises, you know, which is, you know, so I have to form this binary number, right? We have to start from 0 and go up, but in what direction? And that direction is where byte order starts to play a role, but not at the bit level. We don't bother too much about the bit level. We do deal with it at the hardware level. But in JavaScript, you know, this is what is important to understand. So think of it like this, okay? Let's imagine there's a network pipe here, right? So if there's a network pipe here, the first byte that comes is called B0, the second byte that comes is called B1, the third byte that comes is called B2, the fourth byte that comes is called B3, right? So this is what I call network byte order, you know, but you have to imagine your pipe on the left. And remember that your pipe is always on the left. So if stuff is coming over the network, this is the order. And this is also called Big Endian, which I don't know, it's a very cryptic name that doesn't really convey much. Network byte order is nice. But basically what I'm saying is that the least significant value of a number is at this end, the most significant value is at this end. And so let's say if I were trying to write, you know, 1, the decimal number, I would write 1 here because it's the least significant position, right? Which means that 1 would mean 1. If I would write 1 at the most significant position, 1 would start meaning a bigger number. And I don't want that. I want to send 1, so I would write it here, right? In Little Indian, it's the reverse. So if your data is coming from here, you assume the reverse order. And why are we doing this? See, byte orders are important when you're thinking in a next level higher binary numbers, which is, you know, words. So I want to combine bytes together and I want to think in words. And in words, I can either store the bytes like this, the way they came from the pipe, or I can store them like this, where, you know, I do this. And this is important because hardware architectures kind of vary underneath. So, you know, I would do the opposite. If I wanted to store 1, decimal 1 in a Little Indian notation, I would store 1 here. So it just seems wrong, right? It seems like, you know, bigger values should be on this side. At least in our traditional decimal stuff, bigger values are always on this side. So, all right, so that was kind of the basics, right? I wanted to cover the number system because if you don't understand that, you can't understand the rest of the stuff. So, raise your hands if you still don't understand numbers. But numbers in JavaScript. All right. So numbers in JavaScript are this follow this particular standard called IEEE 74 precision floating point. Blah blah blah. The basic important thing to note is that it's stored in 64 bits, which is 8 bytes. But it's not stored in our number system that I just saw, right? It's stored in a slightly complicated format. The point of this slide here was that we will deal with JavaScript numbers a lot, but we will not deal with them in this form because they get converted the moment we start dealing with them. So the moment you start using binary operations in JavaScript, most binary operations will just convert this number into something else. And we'll look at what that something else in a little bit. So binary operators, especially when you're dealing at the bit level, are called bitwise operators in JavaScript. And what's important to note about this has to do with that numbers in JavaScript thing. If you have a bitwise operator, the value that is sent to that bitwise operator, the operand, the entity that the operator is acting on, is always converted into a signed 32-bit integer, which is stored in big endian, right? This is important to us. And it's 2's complement format. Just ignore 2's complement. 2's complement basically means that, you know, the sign bit is on the is always on the left side, right? So you have this one location for plus and minus. But essentially what we need to know is it's 32-bit, which is 4 bytes, and it's big endian, right? So it looks like what we were drawing a little while ago. Now let's look at the basic operators that are available. So we have a bitwise AND, right? And this is very fundamental again. A bitwise AND basically says if you have 2 numbers, number 1 and number 2, and you look at all the bits, right? So this is a 32-bit integer, right? Like stuff is in JavaScript. There are 32-bit values. But when you're doing an AND, places where both of them have 1 become 1, everything else becomes 0, right? And this is a simple bitwise AND operator and should be easy enough to understand. A bitwise OR basically says that if one of them is 1, the stuff becomes 1, right? The answer becomes 1. So if one of the bits is 1, the answer becomes 1. XOR, a lot of people aren't generally familiar with it, so I'll explain it a little bit. And it's a very useful operator. But basically what it says is exclusive OR, meaning only one should be on. If you're comparing bits and you start from here, see in this number also has 1, this number also has 1 at this location, these two also have 1, but this one only has 1 at this location. So, you know, these which are exclusively 1 and only one of the numbers become 1. It's hard to explain, sorry. NOT is basically, you know, just reverse the bits. So you have 0, put 1, if you have 1, you put 0. Shifts are important to understand. Shifts are important. Shifts are very simple, though. All they're doing is, you know, if you have this number, When I say, so this number is 9, and when I say 9 left shift 2, all you want to do is you want to move all the bits this side and insert 2 here. Right, so move all the bits to the left and insert 2 empty zeros there. Bitwise right sign propagating right shift is, you know, the opposite of this is this thing, where what happens is here it looks the same, right? What I did was, instead of moving in this direction, I moved in the right direction, right? So I had these two bits fell off, correct? But there's something unexpected happening here, which is clearer from a signed example. So 9 was an unsigned value, so it didn't make a lot of difference. But it was minus 9, right? It makes a difference. Makes a difference because when I shift, the empty spaces don't get filled with zeros. They get filled with ones. And this is very important. This is very important. If you want them to be filled with zero, you use a different operator, which is 3 arrows. And in that case, this will get filled with zero. Right? But this is important to understand. So, alright, so far what we did was we understood, you know, how binary numbers work. We then looked at what can I do in JavaScript to deal with binary numbers. The next thing to think about is, how do I organize? So far I've only looked at integers, and we've looked at integers also very briefly. So the way you store, the only way we have to store binary, reasonably store binary information so that we can operate on it is the number data type in JavaScript, okay? But the number data type, as we looked at before, has this weird 64-bit format that we don't really care about. But when we need to work on it, it gets converted to a 32-bit format, right? So once we have these, so let's start thinking of numbers as 32-bit signed integers. And let's just for a minute assume, even though in JavaScript you have floating point numbers and you have, you know, longer numbers, but let's for a minute just assume that the numbers available to us for the purpose of binary data are 32-bit signed numbers, right? And then once you have this unit, a 32-bit signed big Indian ordered number, which is basically saying that there are 4 bytes in the big Indian order in that number, we can say, oh, you know what, this is not number. I will treat it as something else. I will treat it as my own way of creating new data formats. And this is where encoding starts to come. So most of the time, we only deal with text information. And what is text information? Right? It is, in the end, in computer science, everything is numbers, right? And if you keep going lower, everything is bits, right? So if it's all bits, text is also bits, right? The only thing is, it is in a certain format which says number 65 is A, right? So there's a table which says, you know, this number is this character, this number is this character, this number is this character, and a byte can have 0 to 255 numbers in it. So you assign a number to each of these values, and assign a character to each of these values, and you can create a text format, right? This is what our old UTF-8 format. The newer ones have expansion capability, and they can deal with 2 bytes at a time because they need more space. And we can have more characters. But this is what text formats are. But text formats have a problem, okay? The problem is, if I write the number, if I write the number 10 in text, right? Number 10 in text needs 1 byte to store 1, and it needs another byte to store 0. Why? Because 1 is actually 49, I think, if I'm not mistaken. 40? 1. 1, huh? Okay. So 1 in Unicode is 41, 0 in Unicode is, you know, some other number. And I need 2 bytes to store 10. But we just saw that I can store 0 to 255 in 1 byte, right? So there's a problem here. There's a problem because I now suddenly need 2 bytes. Actually, I need more strings also store length. So I end up storing like 4 or 5 bytes to send 10, right? I needed to send 10 to my server. And instead of sending 1 byte, which is where 10 can fit in, I send 4 or 5 bytes. And this is a problem, right? And this is why you need to look at data at the binary level. Another good example could be that, you know, I'll actually get to that example in a little bit. But basically, text is heavy, right? So JSON is text, which is most commonly used by us. XML is even heavier text because it has its own metadata in text, a lot of it. So text formats are bulky, and we need something else. And all I'm doing, I mean, the reason I'm giving this talk is to promote the idea that go look at something else. And there are a lot of options, and I will introduce them a little bit in a little while. And these things, we generally tend to call them binary formats, but even text is binary, but, you know, in common language, you tend to call them binary formats. Binary formats are basically a set of rules which define data types, right? So what they essentially say is, if I have an integer, store it like this, right? If I have a float, store it like this. And typically these formats will look like, okay, you know, in case of an integer, put a tag which represents it. So, I'll take a good example. Okay, so you're getting a stream of bytes on the network, okay? And the length of a byte stream is unknown, let's say. So you don't know how many bytes are going to come. You're getting bytes. So how do I start reading data from these bytes? And there are several ways. One is you and I, so you're sending me some data in a byte binary stream, and you and I pre-agree that, you know what, the first 4 bytes that you send me are the length, and then followed by that length. So the first four bytes that you send me, 1, 2, 3, and 4, are length, right? And followed by that is length bytes of data, which I can use as a string. So this would be definition of a string data type. And this is my own custom format. Some format might have this, another format might not have this. But essentially what I do is send length first, and then send length bytes of data, right? And that is what basically all binary formats do. They send in some information about the length. They may send in a tag here which says, okay, you know what? What is coming is a string. So there might be a number assigned to string. Let's say anything that starts with a 2 is a string. Anything that starts with a 1 is an integer. Now, for anything that starts with a 1 is an integer. Now, I could do 2 things, right? I could store the length of an integer here, right, like I did with string, and then store the integer. So I'd need, you know, 4 bytes to store length, and then I need to store the integer. This will make my integer value 9 bytes long. That's not very cool, right? Integers can be stored in 32 bits or 4 bytes. So what's going on here? If you and I both agree that integers are always 32 bits, then we don't need to send this length. And this is what a lot of formats also do, is that they have pre-agreed that, you know what, whenever I want to send you an integer, I will send you 1 and I followed by an integer, I will not send you length, because we both know integers are always 4 bytes. Right? So this is what typical binary formats would look like. And, sorry? So padding could be one of the rules. One of the rules could be, okay, hey, you know what, if an integer is only 1 byte, but what you and I have agreed is that integers are always 4 bytes, then I will pad and put 0 in the rest of the 3 bytes, because I don't want to confuse you, right? So padding would be one of the rules. But data formats essentially are just the set of rules that define what common data types would look like in a binary form, right? And I've talked about fixed width and variable width data types. What's interesting and what is relevant to JavaScript, right? This stuff, everything we've talked so far is mostly common in most languages. What's relevant to JavaScript is how do you store this binary information? And, well, JavaScript traditionally has been pretty bad at it. It's been pretty bad because there is no binary data type. There is no binary data type, meaning that there is no easy data type to work with binary data. So what you typically do is you stuff the data into a string, and then you use these two functions, you know, char code at some location, or you use from char code to create the string, and that's it. It sucks, it's really slow, but that's all we have even today in all browsers, right? It works in all browsers. So if you have to build something that works on binary data in all browsers, string is still probably your best bet. And also, it is your best bet because even if I get to the next slide, the next slide will give a different alternative. The problem is that different alternative first needs to use this. Why? Because your data in a web application is coming over HTTP. And when it comes over HTTP, the response that you get from most browsers is text. At least it used to be. That's changed now, and we'll discuss that. But it used to be just text. So because it is just text, and let's say your server sent you some binary information in text, you need to read that using this charcodec. After you've done that, you could copy it into into an array of numbers, right? So you could instead of using strings all the time, you could use an array of numbers, because essentially what is binary information? An array of numbers, right? But you could do two different things. You could store only 0 to 2. So let's say I have a number. Let's say, I don't know. There is AA, so 0xAA, BB. Right, that is my number. And this number I want to send over the wire. So I send this data over the wire in some format. So this value is less than 32 bits. It can fit into one integer, right? And when you're reading data into an array of numbers, you could store both of these bytes together in one number, or you could choose to store only one byte at a time. And you might want to do this if you want the flexibility, right? So array of numbers could be array of numbers that are always less than 255, less than or equal to 255, or array of numbers which are always less than 32-bit numbers, right? Which is like 4 million something something, the maximum. So you have an option here, and different libraries I've seen, depending on the data format, have tried to do different things. But this is all really, you know, strings and arrays of numbers are really old things. They still work in all browsers, but they're really slow. Yeah, so that's what I'm going to get at. They're not heavy because memory-wise they're just the same. They're heavy because I don't have good operations to deal with them. I don't have data type based indices, and I didn't used to have it. I now have them, right? I now have them. So stuff is changing. We have new specifications. The first one is blob, which is part of the file API spec, if you've read that spec. And the file API spec, they define something called a binary large object. A binary large object is this, in future versions of browser, and already I think in Chrome and latest Firefox, you have blob. But in future versions of browsers, the intention is that whenever you're exchanging data that is not of known JavaScript data types, you'll always be sending around a blob. Right? So for example, today if you read a file using the file API, the result is a blob, right? But this blob on its own isn't very useful because you can't operate too well on it. You need to do other stuff with it.
So in XHR, you can post
a
blob.
Yes, so now XHR2, which is the new XHR specification, allows you to send blobs. So you read a file, you get a blob. You just take that blob, put it into an XHR and send it over, right? That's all. So you could do that. But you could do that only in new browsers. Well, HTTP was never string, okay? HTTP has this header called content type. And content type allows you to send whatever you feel like. The problem was in browsers, we had no way to send an HTTP packet other than XHR or, you know, your traditional form-based submits. And you couldn't change content type. You could. In an old XHR, you can change a content type. It still doesn't work in most browsers. Because you have to do, I think in the old XHR, you have to do this override MIME type blah blah thing in Firefox. And in IE, you have to do something else. So there are a bunch of hacks that you have to do to pull off a new content type exchange. But HTTP supports it. Yeah, I'll get there. So, I was 10. You will load into? No, it doesn't work like that. File API, if this blob is coming from file API, it actually can deal with it. If this blob is in memory, then it's in memory, right? So anyways, I thought it was 10 minutes. Okay, anyways. Similarly, you could receive a blog. In XSR2, you just have to send the response type, and then in our response.response, you'll get the blob, and you can deal with the blob. So how do we deal with the blob, right? Before we start reading it, we can also build our own. So we don't have to read from a file. We can use this class called blob builder and append a bunch of strings to it, and then call the get blob method. And here you can find send in a content type. So it has a bunch of supported content types. And then you send it, you get a blob. Right, this blob object you could use in an XHR and send over the wire, right? But what if? So it is part of the new file API standard. It's, well, you can't really call it standard because it's not in all browsers yet. But yeah, it is part of the proposed file thing standard. It's not in old browsers. So what if I want to read a blob? So as such, the blob doesn't really have a lot of operations on it. But it will let you read it, right? So we can use this file reader, again, part of the file API standard. And you can read it as different things. You can read it as text. And you can read it as a binary string. You can read it as an array buffer. And this array buffer is new. Other stuff is not that interesting. And you'll get that result in this result object. This array buffer is the best thing that's happened for binary data in browsers for a very, very long time. So array buffer is your traditional byte array, which you used to have in other languages. It's an array of bytes. And typically, how you operate on an array buffer is that you create a view, right? So how did I get an array buffer in the first place? I read a blob as an array buffer, right? So I could create a blob using blob builder, then read that blob into an array buffer, right? So this way I can create binary information. Once I've done that, let's say I want to operate on this array buffer. And the way I operate on it is by creating an array buffer view. So array buffers are just the space in memory. And you don't, that object doesn't give you read-write methods. What gives you read-write methods are these views. And views is typically, you know, just a part. It could be starting from the end, beginning until the end, or it could just be a window in between that you're looking at. Once you create, one type of view that you can create is typed arrays. And typed arrays will give you data type specific arrays. So this is interesting. I think the only way I can explain this is by showing an example. So here's what I'm doing, right? I create an 8-byte array buffer, right? So it's an 8-byte location that I've gotten in memory. Then I create an int 32-bit array, so what I'm saying is, in those 8 bytes, give me an array which is indexed by 32-bit integers, meaning that when I go to index 1, I will get the first 32 bits of those 8 bytes. When I go to the second index, I will get the next 32 bits. But I could do something different where I could say uint 8. And in this case, I would get the first 8 bits, not the 32 bits. So here I'll get 32 bits at index 0. Here I'll get 8 bits at index 0. Right? Here I'll get 16 bits at index 0. Right? But, you know, sign is kind of important.
These typed arrays are part of the
language? No. So typed arrays are part of another proposed spec called WebGL. Even browsers that haven't implemented WebGL have started implementing typed arrays because they see the value in it. You don't need. You don't need a WebGL context. And because you need to implement the file API, which everybody agrees on, WebGL, nobody, you know, people, there's no consensus. But file API, everybody agrees on. And file API has array buffers, which means that you automatically just get all this stuff. Absolutely. And edit it, change formats, blah, blah, all sorts of, all. Yes. Well,
compared to the older version.
The typed arrays right now aren't very fast in most browsers. They're almost as, I mean, they're slightly faster than your traditional array approach.
Aren't they meant to be
on GL? No. If you have a WebGL context, then your typed array will get, your typed array operations will happen in the GPU. But if you don't have a GPU context, which is, you know, if you don't have WebGL, then typed array is running in your regular CPU. So anyway, so, you know, we did this. So, Typed arrays are one kind of views. Remember what I said was you need a view to work with array buffers. Typed array is one kind of a view that you can create on an array buffer. Data view is another kind of view. And data view gives you your traditional byte array view. It gives you the flexibility. So typed arrays have got a problem. The problem is that they assume that every value will always be 32 bits or a particular data type, right? Every value will always be 8 bits or every value in that array will always be 32 bits. And that might not be the case if you're dealing with dynamic binary information. So data views, you can use them to, you know, read 8 bits or read 10 bits or 20 bits or whatever. There are built-in functions which lets you read in 8 bits, 16 bits, and you know there are a library of these functions which lets you read them and also let you set them. So you can use a data view if you need a more flexible approach where your data isn't homogeneous, it doesn't look the same. And this is what you would use if you wanted to create a complex data type. So let's say I wanted to send an object over the wire where, you know, first value in the object is ID, and this ID is, let's say, 1 byte long. The second value is a string. Then let's say this is, you know, 100 bytes. It's a fixed length. And then the third value is some age, right, of data type number. So now I need to read first a byte. Then I need to read 10 bytes or 100 bytes. Then I need to read 4 bytes. And a data view would give me that flexibility of reading how many bytes I want. So,
isn't there something similar to structs also?
Similar to?
Structs.
Okay. No. You could create your own, but there's nothing that gives you ready-made structures.
Yeah, yeah, so I'm saying similar to data view, there is something called structs also. Similar to the C-structs. You can combine
You could combine the data view API and create a structure like this. Yeah. But there's nothing that is built into the language. Right, so you could create. Okay, then maybe I missed it. That's also possible. But I mean, right now all I know is that you would use the DataView API to create your own custom data formats or structures. Some people also still use. So Canvas has, you know, a way to store images, and some people use image data to store that because pixels are also 32-bit values, and you can use that information. So this is people use this. It's getting slower and slower compared to typed arrays. The support is almost just the same. So, you know, this will probably go away. So far we talked about, you know, how do I store data and manipulate binary data in memory, but how do I send it over the network? And this is where, you know, your traditional HTTP question comes in. HTTP has no restriction, right? HTTP will let you send an octet stream. HTTP will even let you send a custom header which says, you know, this data is of some other type that I don't know of. For example, you know, Google has created this protocol called protocol buffers. The protocol buffer sends a header which says X protocol Google, X protocol buffers Google. And if that happens, then you can send binary information over HTTP. So HTTP doesn't have that restriction. The restriction was because of the XHR implementation. But people were getting around it using, you know, form data and things like that. So you could do stuff. Even XHR works, but XHR needs a bunch of hacks to pull that off. The new XHR works just fine. You could also have, you know, WebSockets. And if you have a WebSocket, you basically have the ability to send any binary information. The WebSocket API, sorry? Well, you need to serialize it according to your latency. If you have a data view, right, you could just send that data view over.
That's what I mean.
But what we're talking about really is, so serialization is this abstract term, okay? Serialize from what to what?
And
if it's, you cannot send a blob on a WebSocket. Yes, you can't do that. You need to read it into a data view and then parse the data view and send it over a WebSocket. So finally, you know, these are kind of the basics. I wanted to only cover the basics of, you know, what you can do with binary data. What I would like to urge people is to consider binary information. Consider that you can gain. So for example, I deal with I'm building an application that sends a lot of numbers from the server to the client, right? And if I start sending all those numbers as strings, well, it just becomes really, really big, right? For example, if I want to send 4 million, 4 million as a string is going to take me about 9 or 10 bytes. For 4 million as binary information, it will take me 2 bytes or 3 bytes.
Does HTTP compression alleviate some of that?
GZIP, so it does, but it doesn't really, the numbers just, I don't know, I mean, I'm trying to measure, just doesn't match. I mean, it's almost to the order of, you know, about 100 times kind of difference. If you format and deal with the data format properly according to your data, right? And which is exactly what I'm trying to say. What I'm saying is, if you have data that looks interesting from a binary angle, just consider that option that you could send it as a different data type, not traditional data type. And there are a bunch of, you know, you don't have to cook up your own data type or serialization, deserialization libraries. There are a bunch of them available. There's, you know, there's protocol buffers, there's Thrift, Avro, Message Pack, a bunch of them. There are really old ones like ASN and stuff also. Sorry? Yeah, just last 5 minutes. So, you know, the bunch of them already available. One of the advantages that you might want to consider of thinking about data in binary numbers is, you know, the fast speed that you get with just bitwise operators. So let's say you want to multiply by 8, right? Multiply by, so you have number n, and you want to multiply it by 8, into 8, right? This runs slower than n, left shift 3. You know, knowing that these things are out there is important. Understanding that bitwise operators can help you do fast calculations is important. So I would encourage you to look at bitwise tricks. They're sometimes less readable, but, you know, at critical times, they can get you a lot of advantage. Lighter data exchange, we've already discussed that you can, you know, if you have new data formats, you can improve your network overhead. You can also improve your memory overhead. Sometimes if you want to store data in memory, but you don't want it typed to, you know, JavaScript objects, you could still keep it in binary blobs. You could, of course, build already existing, so using WebSockets, you could build clients to existing protocols. People who are using Node.js are writing interesting protocol libraries. I'm sure when WebSockets become popular, we'll have those libraries in the browser suddenly. And of course, you can do file manipulation. And that was pretty much all I wanted to talk about. Questions?
Anything to add data streams?
Blobs and then data. With binary information, well, pretty much all of computer science, but in browsers, I can give you my example. I'm sending a lot of numbers, and I can just reduce the amount of data transfer that we do by almost 100 times, just by having my own such report. Sorry? Right, I'm sure you use a lot of binary stuff. You can do sound generation, I've seen audio generation, synthesizing examples. You could do file modification, you could read GMPs in the browser for the reason you wanted to. Also, regarding streams, you need a layer on top to manage your chunking and stuff like that, but there's nothing to do. It's just like a better tool. I mean, earlier the old stuff was built on arrays, and now we have better tools.
Thank you.